biblical allegory, a New Testament allegory there as well.
I
never thought of that,
yeah,
but I appreciate it.
Yeah, you're very welcome and may keep it. Yeah, but your heart goes out to her. At the end, she still goes to jail.
She does. It's one of the cruel ironies of the case and of the criminal justice system in Texas at that time, mm-hmm. That this girl, 13 years old, kidnapped, orphaned, raped, impregnated, has her captor's baby, ends up testifying against him as the star witness for the prosecution, winning his conviction, and then is herself prosecuted for associating with a known criminal.
Yeah.
Yeah, unbelievable.
I mean, such a travesty of justice.
It really is.
Yeah.
It really is, yeah.
There's another scene, too, that it jumps, and that's when he picks up the three girls who will join them on sort of a joyride, and it is at the end of it that he is arrested and found. But they were, you know, gay girls.
I thought that was such a telling window into his thought process that, and this is true, as he was escaping from Utah with a posse chasing him on his way to Texas where he was wanted for murder, he stopped and picked up three young girls hitchhiking by the side of the road. And they traveled with them for a ways. Two of them got off. And when they rode into Texas, the one girl stayed with them so that when he was arrested, he had the two girls in the car with
him.
Yeah.
Yeah. His father was in Texas.
Clint Palmer's elderly father, a man named H.P. Palmer, was still in Texas at the Palmer farm where the murder took place.
Yeah. But he doesn't seem to play much of a role.
Correct.
Yeah.
Although he makes a statement that ends up being quite significant in the context of the trial. He says to his father, "I'm hot in Utah," and the father says, "No hotter than you are in Texas, son."
Yeah.
And that line is actually a true line from the trial.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Tell me about the judge.
I don't know that I know that much about the judge. We know his name.
Yeah.
We have the court records. Because the trial was not appealed on the reporter's transcript, there is no reporter's transcript. There's no verbatim record of what was said during the trial. So much of what happened during the trial, I gleaned from newspaper accounts of the trial.
Mm-hmm.
And in turn, those newspaper accounts informed me as to the narrative of what happened during this 1 year that they spent together on the road.
Yeah.
It came largely from newspaper accounts.
How long did the trial take?
It took, I think, 4 days. 4 days.
Yeah, because it seems much longer because the events are interspersed.
Yes. It's amazing how swiftly justice moved in those days. They were arrested, and they tried to put him on trial within like 2 weeks after they arrested him. Because there was a change of venue, it delayed it slightly, but they were still tried within a month of when they were arrested.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What happened to her when she got out of jail?
She was not sentenced to jail. She was sentenced to spend...
juvenile.
To reform school. She went into reform school at age 14, and she was sentenced till age 21. We lost track of her at that point in terms of the research we could do at that time that I was doing it.
Yeah.
We didn't know what happened to her. After the book was written, we found an entry on Ancestry.com put up by her son, also named Dillard. It turns out she survived the ordeal of her childhood. She married at age 21. She lived a normal, reasonably happy life, as far as I know. She raised a son. And she passed away, I think, in 1991. Two, I think it was.
Mm-hmm.
So by the time we discovered her, as you will, she was already dead.
Yeah.
But I have been in communication with her son and her daughter-in-law about her.
Yeah. What happened in their lives? I mean, with the mother who had this background, the poverty, what type of life did he have?
I don't know the answer to that, except that in an odd twist of fate, when I found him, I don't know if it's still the case, he was living in Hugo, Oklahoma, where the story begins.
Strange way life works.
Yeah.
You know, one is so aware of the poverty in the way you've written it. as I said, the Steinbeck feel of the Dust Bowl, the poverty and no way out, and certainly the government was not giving any handouts.
Right, right. It's, I think there's a certain friction that comes in the book from the setting. I think this story would be dramatic in any setting, but the fact that it takes place during the Dust Bowl, during the Great Depression, and in the American Southwest, where it's a remote and beautiful country anyway, I think those elements all combine to just add an extra spice to the soup. Yeah.
Did they really, the two of them, ride on one horse in order to get around?
I'm not sure if that's the case or not.
Okay.
That was my invention.
Yeah, because if you don't have a car, what do you do? How do you get around?
Correct, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, it is known that Palmer stole horses.
Mm-hmm.
It's not too far-fetched to believe that he would steal a horse initially.
Yeah,
to get going.
But to do so much cross-country riding on it was hard to believe.
Yeah.
Yeah. Only if it was true, it could be true.
Right.
Right. Right. Chuck, what would be the next book?
Well, as I mentioned, I have a book coming out. The second installment in the series of legal mysteries is called Green-Eyed Lady. It comes out from St. Martin's Press in June.
Yeah.
After that, I'll either write another literary novel for Bloomsbury, or I'll write the third installment of the
Were you
of the legal
writing
mysteries.
All the time you were practicing law?
No, I didn't write at all when I practiced law. I retired from practice in 2006, and I started writing full-time at that point. And just a quick story, I wrote Hush Money, my first legal thriller.
Yeah. Based on what? I mean, based on what case, what?
Not based on a case, just a fanciful legal thriller, humorous, fanciful legal thriller.
Okay.
And then I wrote Hard Twisted. And at that point, it was 2009, and I didn't have an agent, didn't have a publisher.
Mm-hmm.
I entered both manuscripts in the Southwest Writers International Writing Contest. The year that I entered in 2010, there were 680 entries. Hard Twisted came in second, Hush Money came in first. And that was how my career got started. Within 2 weeks, I had a New York agent. Within 2 weeks after that, I'd sold the legal series to St. Martin's, and I'd sold Hard Twisted about a month later to Bloomsbury.
Okay. All of this happens. How do you keep your feet on the ground?
Well, I've been luckier than most, put it that way.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, second, how did you feel when the first book came in and you saw your name and you realized it happened?
Well, that's always a good feeling. And again, I came about it from a very unusual angle. I walked away from a career, you know, as a partner in a major law firm at the height of my career at age 50. With the notion of taking a chance on becoming a novelist. So I'd say it was an admixture of relief and mm-hmm. And excitement.
Tell me about that, the day you finally left the agency and the year before. Didn't you have a lot of qualms about what you were doing?
Yes, of course you do. You don't make a decision like that lightly, obviously.
Yeah.
So it was a definite leap of faith on my part. But it was something I knew I always wanted to do. I knew I always wanted to write a novel, and I thought, given a lot of different circumstances.
Had you been ill, or had there been a nothing?
Well, yeah, I turned 50. That was I had a classic midlife crisis.
Yeah. Well, it couldn't have happened to a better man, because, I mean, the book is really quite, it's so real that it is real, but the way you make me the reader see what this young woman is going through. And at no point, except once, with the couple, I guess it was the Gouldings, where she could have left and they would have taken care of her. They wanted her to be their child. Did they have a role in her life after?
Not that I'm aware of.
Yeah.
Not that I'm aware of.
Yeah. But that, of course, was the writer's license.
Absolutely right. The relationship between Lottie and Palmer is entirely fictive. The relationship between the Gouldings and Lottie is entirely fictive.
Yeah.
I just had a bare bones of facts onto which I put not just the flesh and the organs and the skin, but also the emotions and everything else.
And what happens to a young girl who is desperately alone, looking for a father, but being told, stop looking, the police are after him. If they find him, you'll be in trouble too. And of course, that was the story of what happened to her with staying with Palmer.
I think that's pretty much a classic Stockholm syndrome situation, where the captive is convinced that they can't go for help, where the captor becomes the captive's only lifeline. And again, she was truly an orphan. Her mother had died. Her father had been murdered by Palmer, unbeknownst to her. She really had no place to go. She was homeless to begin with.
And the father kept saying to her, have you had sexual relations with this man? And makes her, I thought he was going to kill her then.
Well, exactly. I had to create a situation where going with Palmer was almost as attractive an alternative for her as staying with her father.
I thank you. Will you autograph my book?
I'd be honored to, Connie. Thank you.
And if you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.conniemartinson.com. We'll tell you about some other books we've liked recently, including Tom Reese's new book, The Black Count. It's both nonfiction about the French Revolution and Alex Dumas, the father of Alexander Dumas. True story, you will find it fascinating. Support your local library. Go in, take out a card. Another great lawyer who wrote his books, Louis Neiser. Go read his My Life in Court, and you'll find it in your library. And have a good week. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Connie, so much. Appreciate it.